Hello everyone, my name is Malte Schellers and welcome to the update video of the Pivot Painter add-on version 1.2. In this version, you are able to create hierarchy-based mesh movement for things like trees or bushes. You see in this tree, every branch is moving independently of each other and are connected to the main branch, to the main trunk. And every branch has sub-branches which are also moving independently. But all this is one static mesh without any bones or anything complicated. It's just a shader here. And this can be also used for things like hedges. And you can see I can move around them and they are bending aside. And this is basically the add-on, what you can create with this. For everyone who doesn't know, this add-on is completely free for everyone. And yeah, let's dive just right into Blender and I show you how to create your own trees with that. So the first thing you do in Blender is you go to Edit, Preferences, and you install the Pivot Painter add-on, because by default it's not in here. So we go to Install, we go to our folder and we select our Pivot Painter add-on version 1.2. Click on Install add-on. After a second it appears here. And you can see in version 1.2 that this is the newest version. If that's not the newest version, you can remove this by clicking this one here, restart Blender, and then do the same process again to install it. And right now we see under object, we have this new option, Pivot Painter in here. So that's how we can access it. And for simplicity reasons, I model a very simple tree right now. So just to give you the simplest example on how to build something that is behaving like this example in the prototype level I showed you. And this is our main branch actually here. So we can give it a material called branch. And we also want, or let's call it trunk. Trunk is better. And now let's give it some branches. So we move it up, make it a bit smaller and taller like this, and yeah, it gives us a new material and we call this one branch, and we duplicate this one a few times, like 90 degrees and like this, and now we have our branches. They're all called branch in the material at least. And now we want to have some leaves, so I create some basic leaves. Very simple here, but this is just for test purposes to show you how it's working, how it's behaving. And I call this one, make a new material, and I call this one leaves. And I also give this one the leaf material. Now I rotate this one again. And again, and so now we have different materials for all the layers and we have different objects. So this is a basic form. What we do right now is we actually select the objects and we parent them together. So we parent the leaves to the branches. And we do this with all of them. So we now have all the branches actually controlling the leaves. And now we go do the same thing basically with the branches to the trunk. So we have the branches controlling the leaves and the trunk controlling everything. And right now we can select them all. Before we merge them into one object, we go to the object Pivot Painter. And now we can merge them together. And the difference here is, like now we see in the vertex colors, if you go to the vertex colors, you see different colors here everywhere. Every object has a slightly different color. And this is basically just like a normal map. So everything that is pointing straight up is colored this bluish color, and everything that goes more in an extreme angle has the normal map colors basically. And if that's all one color, that means that you merge the object before you run the add-on. So make sure it has different colors, then it's working as intended. So we can go back and now our object is ready. So we have our three materials in here and we have one object with all the UV maps as well. So The first two UV maps are up to you what you do with them, but the other ones contains the data that is used by the Pivot Painter add-on. And yeah, you can also use these meshes with all the default Pivot Painter example materials from the example project from Unreal. But for now, we go to File, Export, FBX, and we just save our file somewhere. Make sure that selected object is turned on and export. So over in Unreal, we now can import our mesh. So we go to the folder. In my case, I create a new one called test. And in here, I right click, import FBX and open. One thing that is important is we want to vertex color import option to replace to import this from the file. So we click import. We can ignore the smoothing group warning, and right now we have our object and we can place it in our level. It's all fine. And now let's start with this with the materials, with the trunk basically. For now, we want to give it some movement. And the way we do the magic in here is by using material functions, which I will also put in the video description for download. So you can follow along. And here we have the trunk. For the trunk material, we drag it in and we connect the world position offset with here. If you now save, you now can see that the trunk is moving slightly, but yeah, you can see, and all the other branches are not following. So for this, we are ready here. So we can close this. We open the branch material, and in here, to make it follow the trunk, we also drag in the trunk movement here. And right now, if we save this, you will see that the trunk, the branches are following the trunk like this, but they don't have their own movement right now. To give them their own movement, we also drag in the branch material. And now we hold A and click to create an add node, and we just add those movement vectors together, so we can save this one. And now it will follow the trunk, but also have their own branch movement. And we wait a second. And yep, that is working. One thing that is important is the option, the input here is leaves. So in here we have a static bool, because this one is a branch material, so it's not leaves, so we can have this to false. And save this again, and now we have this material basically ready. And we can do the same thing with the leaves material, where we just can, actually, we can just copy the branch material part here, copy this over to the leaves, with the one difference that we also have the leaves in here and another add node. So we add all the movement together. And in this case, of course, we have the leaves material. So this should be true in this case. And now we connect this with the world position offset. And then you will see that the leaves are also moving with the branches and with the trunk. So give it a second. And now we are good to go. And you can see, yep, we have some movement in here. So the next part is, of course, to create basically inputs for all the possible inputs we have here. So hold S and create a lot of these parameters. And since this is a very tedious task, I created some master materials for you. So this is even simpler now. You can go to the master material section, which is also available for download. And we have here the branch master, leaves master, and trunk master. And I right click, create a material instance, for example, here with the branches. And I call it my branch master, not like this. And now I can drag this one onto the branches. And I do the same thing for the leaves. Call it my leaves. So with this material instance, we apply it as well here. So you can see, yep, we have now the same material, but it's simpler to tweak. And here in the leaves, so we have here the branch options for the wind. Let's actually start with the branches. We want to have some more constant wind bending. So we can go here to constant wind bending, enable this, and just put in a very high number, like 7 for now. So we can see, yeah, the branches are moving a lot more in the wind right now. And since the leaves are actually not following, we go to the leaf material and go also in the branch settings to the constant wind bending and also type in a 7 in here. So this has to be the same. All the branch settings have to be the same. And now it's following a lot better. The reason why you see it's not following here in the middle is because we don't subdivide it on our mesh a lot. And the real bending is actually more like a curve, but for now, since we don't have any subdivisions in our mesh here, it's more a straight line, and that's why it's not fitting perfectly. But for normal trees that have a lot more subdivisions in the mesh geometry, there you cannot see any movement or any sliding, basically, what we see here. So this is as expected for here, for this case. And we can tweak that in Blender. One additional setting that is interesting is the player can push, right? With this one, you enable this one and save. And now the player can basically push the leaves aside and you have some interaction with that. I save that and move that out of the way. And I place this in for now a bit closer to the ground so we see better the movement we have here. And let's just start by pressing play and see if it's working. Oh, we have our collision still for the object, and that's why I cannot get close to it. So let's open our FBX file and click to collision, remove collision, hit save. And that's all here. So we can close this again. But you also can have smaller collisions for the trunk or something, just not for the branches where you want to interact with. And here I make just sure to save it again and enable it again, because sometimes it's not updating the material instances. This is a bug in Unreal currently. So let's see if it's moving right now. Yeah, or is it? One way to figure out if it's moving or not is by pressing like this eject button up here. And right now we can tweak the material so it's clearer and more obvious if it's moving or not, because we have have here some parameters for the movement. For example, the distance, which is set to 1 meter, so we can go up to 2 meters, 200 centimeters in this case. And right now it should be more obvious if we move through that. Just move it out of the way and go back here, process. And yeah, now you can see it's very extreme right now, but you see it is moving. And so we can go back here and reset this to the default variable value, maybe 150. And we can also, for the leaves, we can for now disable the movement. So it's simpler to see. Right, the movement, the player push is more useful for what's going on? Yeah, it's more useful for like things like these bushes here, where we really can move through that, and not really for a tree. For this red tree, I don't have this enabled because it costs just additional performance, and this is not necessary in most of the cases. Yeah, it looks like what we can actually do right here is we can decrease the maximum bending and also decrease the range a bit, because it's really far movement here. So drag this over and we go here and have like the leaf bending distance. Yeah, put this back to default. And the maximum bending, let's go down to 0.1. Let's see if that is doing. Yep, that looks more natural here. But yeah, this is how you can use this setting as well. Have some nice interaction with the foliage here. This is a nice feature, I think. I hope you like it. So yeah, what else? Now I want to show you how you can change the wind direction and the strength of the wind, because these settings are per level and not per material. And in this demo example here, I put it in the logic for the character blueprint. So I open this one. And here you see we have this event tick node, and it's accessing this parameter value. In the content folder, we will have, or you will have, this foliage material parameter collection. And this is defining like all the things like wind strength, the position where the foot is from the player character, and the wind direction. So these are global variables in your project that every material is accessing. And you can set these variables in your blueprints everywhere with the parameter values. And in this case, I have this event tick node in my player character. And what it does is it gets the position of the character. It subtracts the height, basically, of the character. So this is really the position where the foot is. And then we set the player foot location. And when we want to change the wind direction, we can do the same. So we drag out this pin. You can drag out any pin. It doesn't need to be in the event tick node. It can be changed everywhere. So you can drag out a pin and parameter. We have the set scalar parameter and set vector parameter. So in this case, scalar is for the strength. So we can choose our asset, this one that we have in the content folder. And the name is the wind strength. So we can just set the strength to something like zero. Zero is a multiplier. So when we multiply by zero and we start the game, then we see everything stops. We can still run through our foliage, but the wind is gone, right? Also for the tree, and this is one single parameter that we can change. If we make this value bigger than one, then it's now two, twice as strong as before. So we go now, and you see, yep, it's a lot stronger, the wind. And we also can use another vector parameter. I just copy this one, and instead of setting the foot location, we can also set the wind direction. And I connect the spheres. And I make here something like a vector to linear color, because this is a color, because the material is sampling that. And now we can set the wind direction. Before it was from negative x to positive x, so now we can change it to y. This vector should be normalized, so all the values are together the length of one, basically. And now it's coming from the y direction. So if you play that, like we look in this direction, so the wind goes to the right from now. But if you play, now it goes to the right in this direction here. And this is how we can set the wind direction. Now it's twice as strong and coming from this direction. The last thing I want to talk about is the performance part, actually. So we have a lot of moving foliage in this example project, but how about performance? And to better talk about performance, I first want to show you a different project. And this is the example project from the Unreal Engine, the Pivot Painter example. And you can find this in the learning tab of the Unreal Engine launcher, in the Epic Games launcher. And in here we also have this tree, and also a lot of other examples where we can have foliage movement and stuff like this. And this add-on, the Pivot Painter example add-on, is to 100% compatible with the examples in here. So you can just drag and drop your shaders from here onto our meshes that you created with this add-on, except this tree. And I noticed this as well, because this is also hierarchy movement, similar to what I did. And so I analyzed this tree, why it's not working, and it looks like this tree is using a completely different structure of how the UV maps are used and called and everything, really. So it was no wonder that this is not working. But also this tree is not working with all the other examples, example shaders from this Pivot Painter examples project. So this looks to me more like a prototype here. But we can use it as a performance guideline because it's really clear to see what's going on here. So we start this project and hit play. I quickly make this a little bit bigger. And to see, to talk about shader complexity, it makes a lot of sense to go to press the F5 key and to go to the shader complexity view mode here. And what we see is now everything is in the green area, so performance should be good. But, and this is something that we have to keep in mind, this is only the pixel shader that we look at. So how expensive is every pixel? So this is the color that we see. But on the bottom of the screen, we see this bar, which ranges from good, bad, to extremely bad. And this tells us not only the pixel shader cost, but also the vertex shader cost, the small VS. You see this on the bottom left, right. It's in the green area, the VS, the vertex shader. But if you hover our crosshair, the middle of the screen, over the tree bark here, you see it's jumping. And it's right now in the middle between the red and the green area, so in the brownish area here, in the dark area. And you see the performance for the vertex shader is a lot worse here in this case, which makes sense because the tree is actually moving here. And this gets even more extreme if you go up a level higher, like the branches. If you hover our mouse there, now we are in the red area, really, in the dark red area. And you see this is the real cost that we have to care about if we make this shader like moving in the wind. And since this is not working with all the other example project, example materials in this project here, I did this entire material and optimized this on the way. And this is it right here. So this is the same tree material that you can download. And if you now hover our crosshair over the trunk, now you see we are still in the bright green area. And even when we go to the next level, so layer 2, now we are still in the dark green area. So this layer is still more cheap than this one, that old tree bark, which is in the dark gray area. And we can go one layer further. So the third layer, the leaf layer we have, is also in the dark gray area. So it's pretty much the same as the first layer of the tree. So this is how much I optimize the performance on this thing here. And yeah, one note that is also interesting is the original content example tree only supports 2 layers, and this add-on supports 3 layers, which is, I think, a great improvement. So you can have more detailed animations that is also a lot more performant than the old tree example here. So this is a good thing. And now I want to go back to the other project and talk to you about things that you can optimize to reduce the costs further. And one way to optimize this is to really use level of detail objects, because the pixel shader is of course determined by how many pixels you have on screen and not so much by the amount of vertices. Of course, there's something that we call quad overdraw, which also costs a bit of performance, but the real costs of the pixel shaders are really the amount of pixels that we have. But in this case, the movement happens per vertice. So this is all done in the vertex shader. And this is dependent on how many vertices we have. So if you use level of detail objects that reduce the amount of polygons and vertices in the distance, then the shader complexity is of course less. And it even makes sense to, when we look at this field here, I don't have any LODs for this one, and this performance is still okay, but of course you can optimize this. If you look into the distance, we see barely any movement, so it would make sense to use a shader for the lowest level of detail object that doesn't have any movement in it, so we save additional performance there. And this is a really good way to scale the performance costs that you have. And I would even say that you can use this shader on really every game. Any free-to-play game that should run an even integrated Intel CPUs with integrated graphics, even they should be able to perform this. And yeah, this is all about performance. I hope you like it. And as well as the end of this video, I want to say it again. This add-on is completely free, so you can download this. The shader is completely free, so the functions that I have here, and also the master materials. And on top of that, I also put this entire level that you see here also available for download, so you can download it for yourself and try it out and run around here to see what you can do with it and have a quick way to get started with this add-on. And this is really all for this video. Thank you all for watching, and I wish you a great day.